Welcome, dear viewers. Today, we have a very eminent academician, Dr. S. G. Gopala Krishna, with us, who is also the director of the Nagarjuna Group of Institutions. Sir, you have been a part of academics for the last 4 decades. So in your experience, you would have come across several students and their different careers on different perspectives, etc. So let us have a small discussion on how students, or rather for the second POC students, when they are finished with their examinations, what are the different options they have and how a successful career can be built for them.
Yeah. Now, the schooling, particularly in India, up to 10th standard, they don't have much choice. Other than CBSE, ICSE or state syllabus. The syllabus little bit varies, but other than that, their course of study will be same up to 10th standard. The moment they come to the pre-university, at that time there is a branching option. So the students will branch out to science, commerce and arts. Okay. Now when we say science, commerce and arts, already the students might have made up their mind to pursue some kind of career in that particular specialized field.
Right.
So coming to the science as it is, there are a lot of options today. A student can study medical, dental, Ayurvedic medical, Unani, all that in the medical sciences. Paramedical courses are there. In engineering, we have engineering courses. About 28 undergraduate courses are there in the VTU, and we have architecture course under the engineering stream. The students also have, if somebody is interested in BSc agriculture, they have the option. So there are varieties of options under the science stream itself. Coming to the engineering as it is, there are a lot of branches. As I mentioned, 28 undergraduate courses are there, and a student can select any of the course which they would like to pursue. Now, what is the basis on which the student can select the course? It should be the interest that the boy or the girl has on that particular specialized field. Now, for this, what I suggest the students is that they should make a visit to the college. A few of the colleges they can visit, engineering colleges, and find out which are the branches that are operational there and what is the kind of profession that they can pursue after that. Based on that, they can select the branch of study. In our college, for example, we have 5 branches of undergraduate courses. We are with conventional branches such as civil and mechanical engineering. We have the IT branches such as electronics and communication engineering, computer science and engineering, and information science and engineering. If the student is having some mechanical mind, that means if he is interested in machines, automobiles and such other areas, then they can select mechanical engineering. If a student is interested in building, for example, building construction can be there, maintenance can be there, design and implementation, testing, all that is there. A student, if they are interested in the civil engineering field, they can select that. Now, coming to the IT branches, usually we say the job numbers are large in IT branches. Coming to the conventional branches like civil and mechanical, the branches, the job opportunities will be limited. But in order to get a job, the student should be having sufficient fundamental knowledge. If they have the fundamental knowledge, that is the usually the application and the industry's expectation is also that. If they have the fundamental knowledge, they can definitely apply that. They can study anything and do the work there. Particularly if a student is interested in mathematics, if they like subject mathematics, then they can go for electronics and communication engineering. If they little bit lesser interest towards mathematics, then they should take up computer science or information science, where the logical thinking and logical approach is more required. Conventional branches like civil and mechanical, anybody can orient, provided they have the interest.
Now there are private universities and the other colleges available for doing their engineering course. So can you please elaborate on the differences and what the academic part of the respective colleges?
We have different types of universities in our system. state-run universities, central universities, deemed universities and private universities. These are all the university systems that are existing in the country. Now, coming to the fact that the state, central and deemed university, usually the UGC grants such universities, and then the central government MHRD department will approve that. Now, these are the institutes of repute. Now, coming to the private universities usually are approved by the state government by an act. Now, coming to the state government approval for the private universities and the autonomous and other affiliated colleges are under one university system. Private universities cannot affiliate any college, whereas a state university can give the affiliation to a college. Now, once the college gets the affiliation, after that, the college, if it performs well in all the parameters like teaching learning, research and development, student development, placement, all such parameters considered, then the college can go for autonomous status. Autonomous status, one advantage will be the college will function and the curriculum change can happen very frequently, but finally the degree will be awarded by the state-run university. In our case, for example, Nagarjuna College of Engineering and Technology, it is under the autonomous status affiliated to the Vishweshwaraya Technological University. VTU started in 1998 and it is in existence for the last 21 years. It has made a very good name world over. So the degree from VTU is automatically recognized. Whereas if you compare this degree with a private university degree, the private university should do some marketing and should exist itself and should propagate, and they should make a name in the industry and the job market. Then the private university graduates will be accepted by the industries. Now, for autonomous colleges, such problem does not exist in the state of Karnataka. We are all with the Visheshwaraya Technological University, hence our graduates are recognized throughout the world. They also can go for MS and such other programs, master's programs abroad, and pursue their higher study. So that is also possible. This is the main difference between the private university and the autonomous institutions.
Sir, you said that Nagarjuna College is an autonomous institution under VTU. Could you please elaborate a little more on the autonomous status which has been granted?
Yeah. We have received the autonomous status from the university as well as from the approval from UGC regarding that. We have all types of accreditations like NAC A grade accreditation, NBA, four of our undergraduate courses are accredited, and we also have ISO 9001:2015, ISO 14000, ISO 22000, all these certifications we have. Now, when we have these kinds of accreditations, the advantage is for a student who studies here, the degree will be recognized abroad. Now, under autonomous status, our college, the advantage is curriculum design can be done frequently. The industry technology will be progressing very fast, and we need to update our students in tune with the industry standards. To do that, the changes in the syllabus or the curriculum is to be done very frequently, maybe yearly once or so. When we do that, students will be ready with the industry applications. Now, under the autonomous status at NCET, we provide the students international internships. We allow the students to go to 10 universities abroad. In countries like Greece, Athens Institute of Technology, Rome, UK, and such other countries. We also have one more method wherein we can imbibe more practical knowledge to the students. In fact, under VTU, the curriculum, every semester the student will study two laboratory courses. Whereas in our college, we have two laboratory practical courses. Additionally, we have included what is called the integrated course, where a student will study 3 hours of theory and 2 hours of practicals. Thereby, the understanding of that subject will be better. So now 4 subjects in all in a semester having the practical applications. Therefore, the students, the skill development can happen very easily. Not only that, we also have introduced one more program called the project-based learning. Every student can take up this project-based learning depending upon the interest they have. It can also be termed as a mini project what our students can do. Mini products can be developed. So this project-based learning gives the exposure. Whatever they study inside the classroom can be applied and they can do the project on a smaller scale so that they learn better the application of what they have studied in the classroom. Now this project-based learning is another tool. So additionally, we also have the electives. In our college, we have 3 levels of electives. The foundation electives at the level 1, wherein the student can get the knowledge of each branch of engineering and they can get the foundation. That means the elementary level of that particular branch. Now the next level of elective will be engineering elective, where little more depth and the application from that particular branch can also be included. That is the engineering elective. The third level of elective is the open elective, where a student can pursue the interest that he or she is having. The interest, when I say, we have included very interestingly subjects like martial arts, for example, for the girls. Self-defense today is of vital importance. When the students graduate here and go and join some organization, if they undergo some kind of a threat, then definitely they need to have some kind of self-defense mechanism. In order to get that exposure, we have included martial arts as one of the open elective. The advantage, many girl students have come forward and they have undergone this course. We invite experts from the city and they come and train our students on this. There are so many other open electives which are, for example, the national instruments, LabU. You have sports, you have the dance, music. All these can be the open electives. Any student interested in any of these things, they can take up one course under open elective like this. The internship and the project work they can do. The internship, usually every semester, every year, after that there'll be 2 months of gap for the regular students, vacation in fact. So during this vacation, the students can go to the industry for internship. They can get them exposed to the industrial environment working, as well as they can also get the knowledge of what they have studied in the classroom applied there in true in the industry. That exposure also they'll get. So internship the students can take up, and finally the project work also can be taken up in the industry. A continuation of the internship can be the project work, thereby a very good project can be executed by the students.
Sir, you spoke about the open electives, how a student could probably take music, dance. Then you told even about the international internships where the student gets to participate and the activities such as the project work which can be done in the industry. So how exactly do these factors contribute to the student's success? How exactly does it put a weightage into their resumes when they are going for placements?
Yeah, definitely yes, sir. The idea of introducing all these electives like this is for the overall personality development of the students. Now when I say this, I'll give you one example. One of our student who underwent the international internship last year came back and attended some of the placement interviews. In the Infosys placement drive, he was asked some questions and it was very convenient for him to answer the questions because of the exposure that he had under the international internship. So after going to international internship, he developed, apart from the technical knowledge that he has gained, he has developed the communication skill, he has developed the leadership skill, he has developed the teamwork, working together under a senior professor in the international university. See, all these are different things which are very essential for improving a student's overall personality. So therefore, all such open electives, when we say, definitely it will give a very good exposure for the student, and thereby they can better perform in the job market.
Sir, apart from placements which we just spoke about, how the student can get a job into the company, what are the expectations from the industries? As an industry, what are the technical expectations? What is the market right now for engineers on the whole?
Engineers have a very good job market. Jobs are available in plenty. Industry people, when they come here for placement drive, they say, we want these many engineers. But one rider is that the students should have the skill. They should have the fundamentals of the subject. See, it is only when a student is having the fundamental, he can apply that and develop himself in the latest technology. Industry also, the technology is not stagnant. It is continuously progressing. When we say the technology is continuously progressing, the student also should have the capability of learning new technology when they join the job market. So therefore, learn to learn is what is required from every engineering graduate. Now, only when a student can learn, only when a student can have a very sound fundamental knowledge, it is only when he can communicate that properly, it is only when he can do the teamwork in an organization, when he can show his leadership quality, then he will be a successful engineer in the industry.
Now let us say a student chooses mechanical engineering, and after his graduation, he usually, sometimes they get placed in companies like Infosys, Wipro, etc., which is an IT branch, which is not somewhat related to the academics what they have studied. So his question was, how do students make up a career such that they can follow what they have studied? How do you preserve the branch which they are originally from?
Yeah. Now, since you mentioned about the mechanical engineering branch, I'll take the example of mechanical engineering only. A student, if he is interested in mechanical engineering, he should pursue core mechanical engineering job. I do agree with that.
Right.
Now, there is another phase of it, wherein there are some software jobs available under mechanical engineering stream, like CATIA, CAD-CAM, 3D printers, all such, even including the CNC machine programming, robotics, all these are the applications. Though they are cross-migrated to IT and electronics area, but the mechanical engineering foundation is required to handle that. So it is the student's interest. They can pursue in core mechanical engineering job only, but then lot of electronic applications are coming in anyhow in the mechanical engineering field. As you see today, the automobile industry, for example, driverless cars, we talk of that. When I say driverless car, the sensor should be there that should sense the obstructions and the directions, change, route, all such things should be merged. Though there is a lot of mechanical applications, there is also the electronic application involved in that. So I cannot say that I will be isolated and I will do only machine turning and think like that, I will be in the core mechanical only. No, we have to study the other areas which are quite useful to our job in the industry. So it is only then we will be useful to that industry. So application of these various things is definitely very useful. So there is nothing like core job. The application of other electronics and including the software also is very essential now.
Sir, we have one more very interesting question from one of our students. So he is from the agriculture background and is interested in doing engineering. But he does not want to conventionally go for placements or any other options like the usual engineers do. Rather, he has this question that how could he use his engineering course, what he is going to study, in the agricultural field?
Okay. Very interesting question. Now, I feel the application of engineering in industry, in agriculture, is also possible. Now, IoT, for example, if you take, you can prepare a gadget which can sense the plant being destroyed by the pest. If that can be identified sitting in your house, that is the best part of it. If your plants are getting the problem, then you have to use some pesticides for spraying, all that, whatever you want to do, the corrective measure can be taken up. Now, already you must have seen the bore wells and the open wells, the pump houses in the agricultural field, they are about 1-2 kilometers away from the house. It is possible to control such pump sets sitting in the house today. So all such applications can be done. Not only that, the solar application, what I feel is the engineers today should design some of the systems which can have the application of solar energy for storing the agricultural products. This is a very innovative area. If you can store the product in the refrigeration system in a village, the products will get a better marketing price. When the prices are there, good rates are there, at that time the farmer can sell the products. This is another application which probably needs some more strengthening. Research work is going on, but some more strengthening can be done. For example, the application of drone, for example. Drones can be used whether some intrusion is there in his farmland by any of the animals can also be identified by a drone today. Right. Sitting in the house, it can be done. All these are applications which can be done by the engineering graduates. So there are a lot of such applications which can be thought of.
Excellent, sir. It is very interesting as to how engineering can be applied in literally every field today. Sir, could you just tell me something more about the Nagarjuna Institution?
Nagarjuna group of institutions comes under the Nagarjuna Education Society. Very interestingly, Nagarjuna Education Society was started by Srimati Sridevi Rangaraju during 1995-96. With hardly about 20 students and maybe 2 or 3 teachers, she has started the institution in a very small rented house. Today, you see the group has grown to 10,000 students and about 1,000 faculty and other staff members. This is the kind of growth that we have seen. We are under the able leadership of Sri J.V. Rangaraju, who is the director of the Nagarjuna Construction Company. They are our promoters. And now recently, Sri Chaitanya Varma, very young and energetic person, very, very dynamic person. He has taken charge as the secretary of the Nagarjuna Education Society. After he has taken charge, lot of developments have taken place. Very dynamically, he is leading all of us. Now, our Banu Chaitanya, she is also a member of the Nagarjuna Education Society. She is leading and guiding all the institutions under NES.
Thank you very much, sir, for being with us today out of your very busy schedule as the director. It was a pleasure talking and meeting you today. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much.